Quick note, I know that some people don't really like this theory, but you know, theories are theories, and the Ultimania just came out, and of course Square is not going to give everything away. Things are still mysterious and ambiguous, therefore we're all still theorizing here. Just think of this as a different perspective, taking into account the current lore that we do have in regards to Advent Children. You know what time it is. Every time I make a Final Fantasy VII video, I have to wear a Momono.World shirt. And it's Cloud at a McDonald's this time. Not sponsored, by the way, I just love these t-shirts, but maybe someday. Anyway, hi, hello. For those of you who are not new here, welcome back to my channel. For those of you who are, hello, I'm Jazzy Okami. I'm an illustrator, graphic and motion designer, a small streamer, YouTuber, and just a fan of being a fan of things. I just wanted to make a quick video because after finishing Rebirth a couple weeks ago and taking the time to reflect and research and rewatch Advent Children and reread On the Way to a Smile, my thoughts and feelings about the ending to Rebirth plus the concept of timelines is shifted a bit. Just like the fan base taking changing Destiny and Fate the wrong way, I feel like we're also taking the concept of timelines the wrong way, and I'll explain. The overall encompassing concept that I'm housing this theory in, that other people have thought too, is the passage or the journey of souls. So initially, along with many other people, I thought the different worlds were also considered different timelines, but I don't think we should be thinking about the concept of time. I now believe that there aren't any timelines at all. There's only one prime world, there's only one of each character, and all these different worlds, or as Aerith would consider them, dreams, all just exist in the life stream. And honestly, who knows, we still have time until the third game, so my mind might change after this, but yeah, that's all in the fun and theorizing, right? There are a couple reasons as to why I feel this way. As I mentioned before, after the Black Materia fiasco and Cloud and Aerith fall down, they are awakened in another timeline, or so we think, but Aerith considers this one of her dreams. I think all of these different worlds are kind of purgatory in a way, where these are all made up of like people's memories, hopes, and dreams, and just a place where somebody who's so strong-willed and they refuse to enter the life stream, they can live out, you know, their unfinished business and come to terms with, you know, before passing on. Two, an NPC in Cosmo Canyon talks about this a little bit, and we can watch this real quick, actually.
Theory, it addressed the issue of what the life stream is, arguing that spiritual energy is actually a manifestation of our knowledge and memory.
So as Sephiroth explains to Cloud, once they, you know, defy destiny or fate, a bunch of these worlds are created. I feel like it's just a bunch of these people experiencing what they need to before passing on. And this happens with Zack, I believe. During Zack's last stand, we see, or we're led to believe, that he survived, right? But unfortunately, I think his last stand did happen, and as a result of him passing on and crossing over, like in the Crisis Core moment where he grabs Angeal's hand, he's put into this other world.
It's a fascinating theory, but it's incomplete. What about our hopes and dreams? We remember those, don't we?
So those are what forms the world.
Between our real, lived memories and the unrealized desires buried deep in our hearts. What if coming into contact with that energy allowed us to peer through the looking glass, so to speak?
Another moment that made me change my mind was during the scene where the party's on the boat with Gina talk, Aerith puts her hand in the water, the life stream water-ish thing, and around this time, in the separate world, Zack grabs Aerith's hand, the comatose Aerith's hand, and our Aerith, the Beagle Aerith, feels that, and she's caught off guard. So Zack is in the life stream, but in a world within the life stream, one of many. And you may be wondering, okay, so if he's dead, if Biggs is dead, why do we see Marlene? Why do we see Elmira? I think they're all just either shadows or memories. Biggs remembers Marlene and remembers Elmira. He is in the same world as Zack, and this is how they manifest. The real Marlene, the real Elmira, they're still alive in our main world. There's also another thing to note where Zack is having a conversation with Biggs, explaining how the hell they ended up where they are right now and how it felt, almost like their soul being taken out of them, and like that's probably what was happening. And one more thing, I think these popular theories in regards to there being a timeline and then multiples of people, I feel like a lot of people are forgetting to take into account the prior lore and the fact that the creators mentioned that the remake trilogy is in addition to the rest of the compilation. A lot of people are debating whether or not this is supposed to be taking place before or after Advent Children. And just like we have to consider whether or not the word timeline is synonymous with the word world, is leading up to Advent Children synonymous with linking to Advent Children? Some people believe it's before, and I can understand why. There are points and questions as to why one may believe one thing over the other. I believe this is post-Advent Children, which explains why we see Sephiroth so early in Remake. He's not supposed to appear that early. This is Sephiroth being Sephiroth, refusing to die, refusing to fuse with the Lifestream, trying to make things different, and trying to see if he can win this time. And in the book On the Way to a Smile, which happens, this is leading up to Advent Children, there are passages named Lifestream Black and Lifestream White. Black being for Sephiroth and white being for Aerith. I'm going to be reading the Lifestream passages with you here. I have the book. I recommend you reading this on your own time too, just for lore purposes, and it's a good thing to have for a Final Fantasy VII collection. In total, there are 6 Lifestream passages, 3 for each type, so there's 3 black and 3 white, and they happen after each chapter of this book. Okay, everybody gather around, sit crisscross applesauce, I'm about to read you a story. So the first passage is after episode or chapter 1 for Denzel, and it's Lifestream Black. He could feel the Lifestream incessantly trying to erode his spirit, his experiences, thoughts, emotions, and memories. If he gave himself over to the pull of the current, everything he was would be subsumed, his existence dissolved into the great spirit energy that circled through the planet. He would not let that happen. The planet was there to be ruled, to give it his own energy, was to concede defeat. So this is essentially Sephiroth refusing to die. As he said at the very end of Advent Children, he will never be a memory. He felt a surge in the Lifestream, a great upheaval, a sign, he knew, of another defeat. When the Lifestream burst out above ground, it meant Cloud's victory was more secure than ever. Cloud had twice sent him into the Lifestream, and he would not allow it to happen again. If he could only cling to the core of his consciousness, he could keep himself apart from the abyss and stay free of the planet and its insatiable appetite. He had made his decision. Cloud would become the nucleus. He yearned to tell Cloud this. I have not forgotten you. You are still in my mind. You do not know this yet, but soon you will. This guy is obsessed with Cloud, dude. The next chapter is after episode Tifa, and this is Lifestream White. As you can probably tell, it's going to go like back and forth. She was an ancient. Thus, she was able to retain her own selfhood even within the flow of the Lifestream. When she wished it, she could dissolve that self and become part of the planet forever, but it was too soon for that. Just a little longer, she thought. She could feel an aberration in the coursing Lifestream, a will that refused to merge with the planet. Sephiroth. She knew it was the man who had killed her, a man whose fine, handsome features had hidden the vicious spirit that now plotted and schemed within the Lifestream. She sensed he was trying to exert his power in the corporeal world. She wanted to stop him, but how? It was too dangerous to come into contact with him. She stayed far away from his cruel consciousness. That made it harder to discern his intentions, but the one time she did stray dangerously close, she learned something important. His memories of Cloud formed the core of his will. Cloud was her friend. More than a friend, for she had loved him. He was a symbol for everything she held dear. She would protect him. After episode Barret, we go to Lifestream Black 2. When the Lifestream erupted from the Earth, he let the planet have all of those memories that no longer held any meaning. Memories of his boyhood, of his few and far between friends, of battles he fought before knowing his true self, of his life in those bygone days. He let them join the rushing torrent and dash themselves against Meteor. At the same time, the core of his spirit and the feelings that bound it swept across the land through hamlet and city alike, borne by the myriad spiraling tendrils of the great current. As the eruption caught people fleeing in panic or frozen in awe, he decided to leave his own mark. So long as Cloud remembers me, I will always exist, within the Lifestream or on the surface. Even if his own spirit were to disperse, the merest fragment of memory would be enough. It would flow through the planet on the living stream, and then one day, with Cloud's memories to help him, he would regain himself. So, in regards to Sephiroth needing all of these worlds to merge, he needs to collect all of this negative energy, including Cloud's, to become powerful. And that's similar to how Geostigma is formed, right, in Advent Children. This is why, as opposed to the original, Sephiroth is trying to start a war between Shinra and Wutai. After episode Nanaki, we get to Lifestream White 2. It reads, "She discovered there were many more spirits than before who resisted merging into the Lifestream's eternal flow. They were not like him, but she sensed the same hate, the same anger in them that led them to reject the planet and its Lifestream. She believed this was due to the influence he exerted in the living world. Whenever such souls entered the Lifestream, she tried to relieve them of their anger." And this is Lifestream White creating these worlds where they could peer through the looking glass and see their hopes and dreams fulfilled, right? "Beneath the spite and rage would be the memories of an ordinary man or woman, memories with a common person's share of hardships, to be sure, but not devoid of joys great and small." So when Aerith and Cloud awaken in her dream world, aka the Spitz timeline, as we're walking around during our little date, all of these people have accepted that it's the end of their world. They are coming to terms with this, as you've noticed. You see that ripple in the sky, similar to what Zack sees in the Terrier world. But at the very end of Rebirth, Cloud sees it, and he's the only one who can when he's back in the Prime world. But it doesn't look the same as the other ripples. She contrived to free those memories so they could move on and melt into the stream, and soon enough the empty shell of hate that remained would dissolve too. She was pleased that she could help these souls, but she encountered more and more of them as time went on, and she found that she alone wasn't enough. She dove into the current and rushed from here to there, seeking out spirits to help her, other ancients not yet dispersed. The fading shards of their consciousness responded to her call. Heartbreakingly few though they were, she infused them with her memories and gained their help. Still, it wasn't enough. The pollution was spreading, gaining the upper hand. At the end of this passage, Aerith realizes if she wants to stop all of this from happening, she needs to stop it at the source. "Cloud will help me," she says. "I know he will, but I also know it will end up hurting him." The Cloud she knew had a heart so very easily wounded. Sephiroth's been trying to mess with everybody in this remake trilogy, okay? I mean, Barret almost died. But luckily, the Whispers stopped this from happening. He's really trying his best to get Cloud to be as vulnerable and weak as possible mentally and emotionally. And I think Aerith's trying to stop this from happening, or at least trying to prolong it until Tifa can help out in the third game. And I think that's also why Zack's around too, to help relieve this pain a little bit faster. Both Tifa and Aerith have been lying to Cloud or withholding information for his benefit. That's why I think during Aerith's unaliving scene, she's trying to block Cloud's witnessing her dying. She's trying to make it seem everything's okay so Cloud doesn't break down, and that's why Sephiroth's like, you can't see the truth with clouded eyes. This is Aerith's doing. This is not a new timeline happening. This is just Aerith putting in Cloud's mind that, hey, you did save me. Everything's fine. We can continue the journey. We can stop Meteor and all this stuff. For all Cloud knows, she has to stay behind to continue to pray while they go off to the Northern Crater. And with all this going on, this is a lot worse than what Cloud's going through in the original, right? And that's why Zack and Aerith are needed to help Tifa out to, you know, piece Cloud's memories back together. Because there's a huge risk-reward thing going on. It's gonna all pay off at the end and it's gonna be great, but before we get to the point, there's gonna be a ton of resistance, mainly from Cloud. This is probably why they did not show Aerith's burial scene. They're gonna save that for the third game. We, as the players, are Cloud, so we're led to believe Aerith is gonna be totally fine during her unaliving scene. A new timeline is created even. She's gonna be okay. There's just omnipresent Aerith at this point, the Aerith from the Lifestream, the one who's been helping Zack traverse the different worlds to escape him passing on. Because every time he's about to die, whether it's the Shinra soldiers or Meteor coming at him, he is saved. And now, he's in a church, he's in Sector 5 Slums Church with nobody else to be found, and he's believing that he's going to be able to see his friends again. I don't think he believes that he's currently dead. After episode Yuffie, there's Lifestream Black 3. Despite the panic and ongoing turmoil, life on the planet was returning to a normalcy of sorts. He saw something in the new spirits joining the Lifestream. The shadowy places of the heart seemed to define them. It was pleasant to him, the persistent, drifting darkness, especially when he realized it was his actions above ground that had engendered it. I want Cloud to know this is my doing. I want them all to know. He would need a body. There were things he had to say with his own human voice, things he had to tear apart with his own hands. I could use Mother's power. If I had just a piece of her, I could forge another body for myself. And this is the job of the Sephiroth clones, Kadaj, Yuzu, and Laws. That's their task. A couple of people pointed out during the final boss battles in Remake, there are three Harbingers that kind of resemble Kadaj, Yuzu, and Laws. He tried to send a spirit above to walk the surface, but nothing came of it. The planet had consumed the memories of his own form, leaving him with no image on which to anchor his consciousness. But then he found another memory in the life stream that would serve, and he bound part of himself to that image. It took form of a young man. And then he created two more bodies. As I search for Mother, my servants will meet those who knew me, and their spirits will remind me what I once was. Once I have Mother's power, I will exist fully in the living world. It will not be long now. Even if I am incomplete, it will matter not. Cloud will be there, and Cloud will complete me. And after the final episode, episode Shinra, there's one more Lifestream White passage. She tried to think of some way to warn Cloud. As she pondered the problem, all the other things she couldn't tell him rose anew in her spirit, vivid as life. There was always so much she wanted to tell him, but she never had known what to say or how. She hadn't troubled herself over this for a long time, and eventually, she decided there was no point in thinking about it now either, unless she found a way to talk to him. She realized the one responsible for sowing all that hatred was trying to manifest himself in the living world. How was he going to do that? She mustered her courage and went to see for herself. He sensed her and gave chase, but then soon stopped. She could feel his mocking laughter behind her as she fled. There's nothing you can do. Still, she had seen what she needed to see, a glimpse of his intentions. He would begin by using others to act where he could not. Should she do the same? No, she thought. Even if that's possible, I don't want to appear before Cloud as someone else. I want him to see me as he knows me. And this is why Cloud can see Aerith in Advent Children. In Advent Children overall, as people are trying to repair their homes after what had happened in the OG, everybody's in despair. Geostigma is happening. Cloud has it. Everybody has survivor's guilt. The main party is sad that Aerith's gone, and Cloud feels guilty for not being able to save her. And this is all good for Sephiroth. This is all great for him. Aerith's trying to stop everything, and I think she's doing the same thing in the Remake trilogy, and that's why Cloud could only see her at the ending of Rebirth. It's the same thing, it's the same concept, in my opinion. So, all in all, I feel like the answer to where the story's going has kind of always been there. And I'm not trying to convince anybody of anything, I'm just trying to give a new perspective, taking into consideration the lore that we already have. I mean, this is why they re-released Advent Children in theaters before Rebirth was released, right? I know that regardless whether or not this is supposed to lead into Advent Children or this is supposed to have happened after Advent Children, there is the concept of time travel, I guess, for Sephiroth. There's gotta be a way he comes back into, you know, the Remake trilogy where we have to play out the OG again, right? This is why he's trying to make these changes, trying to stir some shit up, you know, try to kill off people, trying to convince Cloud Tifa's dead, she's not real, she's trying to deceive you, she's actually Genova. Him conquering these worlds is not conquering all of the universe, no. It's to conquer all of the life stream. He's trying to make all the life stream black, pretty much. So, just to reiterate, in Remake, Aerith and Sephiroth both know what's going to happen. They already know what's going on. At the end of Remake, everybody has to cross over, defeat the Whispers. Aerith wants to do this in hopes that this will be a good thing for them. Unfortunately, her and Red 13 lose their memory, her white materia turns clear, and she somehow needs to get a fully active one back. The main scenario still plays out pretty much, and it's still going to in the third game. We're gonna visit Medeal, we're gonna visit Rocket Town, all that stuff. All while Cloud's mentally degrading, you know, more and more. Sephiroth does mention, you know, these different worlds, and I feel like he tries to mislead Cloud into thinking that these are separate timelines. I mean, these worlds come and go. Some stay longer than others, and they all fade back into the live stream. And that really just depends on the person whose memories and hopes and dreams created that world, until they come to terms with everything and they pass on. I feel like the third game is either gonna start with us seeing that burial scene, or that burial scene is gonna happen when, you know, Cloud's memories have to get put back together along with Tifa's help. I'm also gonna put a little screenshot here. I saw a Reddit post where they show a screenshot of the original game saying that like the rift or the ripple that we see in the remake trilogy is also here in the OG. So I don't think this is a situation where Square has been like doing this as they go. I think this was planned from since way back when. So Aerith possibly surviving and Zack making it past his last stand, these are all red herrings, I think. I know this is a lot. There's like so many theories and this is great. Like Square has gotten people talking about this game and great conversations are being had. But let me know what you think. Do you have different theories? I know like some people, like Maximilian Dude, he thinks at the very end we see Genova opposing as Aerith, and that's not really Aerith since the conversation is kind of weird. We also must take into consideration translation, because sometimes these translations can be just a little bit off. Thank you guys once again for watching this video. I'm sorry if this is all over the place. I'm gonna try my best to edit this as best as I can, because I just took notes. I didn't really make a script for this. It's just really kind of off the cuff. The concept of souls and different astral planes isn't new to Square. I just don't think they'd go as far as to kind of Marvelify Final Fantasy VII, and I want to believe they're not gonna make this too complicated on us. Don't forget to like the video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe if you want to see more of me. Have a great day or night wherever you are. Don't forget to laugh and take care. Bye.
I wish I could English better. I don't feel like I can English good.